Okay, hi everyone. So today we'll be talking about the expectation maximization algorithm. Usually when this thing gets introduced, we start off by seeing something like you've got a problem where we have some parameters to find, which is usually a theta. So these are parameters. And then something else, which is often a Z, that people call latent variables, okay? And if you're like me, then when you see these things, you see the word latent variables or phrase latent variables, and you think, yeah, I don't really know what that means. And that's probably because most of us need some kind of context to understand where this stuff can be applied. So in this first video, what we're going to do is look at two examples where the expectation maximization algorithm can be applied. So in the second video, we can really go into how it works with a bit of context kind of underneath us. So the first thing we're going to talk about, so example one for context, is a Gaussian mixture model. Okay, so this thing is used for clustering. So let's say we have some data. Let's say we have a load of points kind of over here. We've got some over here. And then just for this example, let's say we've got relatively few here. Okay. So with a Gaussian mixture model, what we do is we fit Gaussian distributions to these points. So for example, as a human being, we can look at this and we can, you know, we're quite good in two dimensions, and we can say, well, we think there's three clusters here. So you might suggest, for example, that these points here in this bottom right hand corner, generated by a kind of Gaussian distribution there, which I've just drawn as an ellipse. So we might say, okay, we think these samples have come from Gaussian normal distribution with mean 1 and covariance matrix 1. So the mean obviously just controlling the center of this circle, and the covariance matrix is kind of controlling its shape, the shape of the ellipse, if you like. And then we might say, okay, well, we think that this stuff probably came from a Gaussian, let's say another one with mean 2 and covariance matrix 2. And then finally, let's say we've got some down here, and we think that these came from our third Gaussian, so mean 3, covariance matrix 3. Okay, what we want to do with the Gaussian mixture model is something that automatically will find these clusters and work out what these means and covariance matrices should be. And you might also notice that there's less points coming from the third Gaussian from the blue Gaussian, so perhaps it's more probable that you'll get points from the first two than the third, so that needs to be kind of part of the model. So the hypothesis that we kind of rely on here, that we lean on, roughly speaking, is we say that each point, so let's consider one of these data points, it's one of those black dots, let's say that the nth point is xn. Okay, and what we're going to do is we're going to say, right, how was this data generated? We say, well, we think that first of all, we pick a Gaussian, so we pick one of our three Gaussians randomly. So randomly pick a Gaussian, and then we're going to say that, okay, the probability that we pick the kth Gaussian is, and it's usually written as a pi k. So we can have a pi 1, a pi 2, or a pi 3. The idea being that through this pi thing, we can control that perhaps it's less probable that we'll generate samples from the, you know, third Gaussian compared to the other two, for example. Okay, and obviously we have to pick a Gaussian, so that's subject to a condition that the summation over all of our k's, in this case we've got 3, has to be equal to 1. So just make sure that we're going to pick one of them. Okay, and then say, well, once we've picked the kth Gaussian, let's say, then the second step is a sample is generated. Generate sample. And you say that xn has come from, and if we picked the kth Gaussian, then it's going to come from mu k Gaussian with mean mu k and covariance matrix sigma k. Okay, so we randomly pick either the red Gaussian, the green Gaussian, or the blue Gaussian. And once we picked it, we generate a sample from it. And that's our kind of hypothesis. We think that's where these things have come from, these data points. So hopefully in this case, now we can see that they are some parameters we need to find. So this theta thing we talked about earlier, in this particular case, what have we actually got to find? So for here, our theta is a collection of, we're going to do this automatically, we'd like our algorithm to find, let's say, okay, all the means. So we've got mu1, mu2, and mu3. All the covariance matrices as well. So I'll just run that down here. So we've got a sigma1, sigma2, and sigma3. And then these probability of sampling from each Gaussian, which is called a, we use pi's here, so pi1, pi2, and pi3. Okay, if you're wondering, these things, just in case you see it in a book or something, these pi's are usually called mixture proportions. If you want to link this to, you know, something else that you've read or something. Okay, so these, this theta, that set, they are the parameters we want to find. Okay, that's fine. So what do we mean by latent variables? That's something that's a bit more perhaps obscure. So latent means hidden, okay? So it's something that's been hidden to us. When this data arrives, these black points, we don't know actually which Gaussian was used to generate each particular point. So that is hidden to us. What we usually do with a Gaussian mixture model is we say that, let's say, associated with xn, we also have, so for each xn, next to it, we're going to have a zn. And this zn is going to be our latent variable, and this tells us which Gaussian generated xn. Good handwriting. So usually the way we do this is we say that, okay, if we look at, let's say that zn is a vector. In this case we're looking at 3 Gaussians, so it's 3 long, and we'd say that zn is equal to 1, 0, 0. Just move over here. If xn came from the first Gaussian, and that zn is equal to 0, 1, 0. If xn came from the second Gaussian, okay, and obviously, as I'm sure you can see coming, it'd be equal to 0, 0, 1 if xn came from the third Gaussian. So if we really think that, so we believe our hypothesis about how the data is generated, then, you know, there's a thing that's been hidden to us. So each of those data points, those black data points, have been generated from one of the three Gaussians. We just don't know which one it is. So those Zs, which indicate which Gaussian was used to generate each Xn, they've been hidden to us. And so our latent variables in this case, which I can write next to the theta, so I'll write as a capital Z. The latent variables are those vectors, so Z1, Z2, all the way up to, let's say we've got n points, we've got capital N points. And that is what's been hidden to us. So there's an example where we've got some parameters defined, which is theta, and our latent variables Z, which tells us which Gaussian they came from. So before we leave this example, the final thing I want to say about it is, if you, kind of loosely speaking, you could find one if you knew the other. So if you knew the Zs, that tells us which Gaussian was used to generate each point. So we might say that, you know, if I was able to tell you that all of the points in the bottom, you know, red here, all of these points came from Gaussian 1, and then if I told you that all of these points came from Gaussian 2, and that all of these points came from Gaussian 3, but I didn't tell you what these what the means and covariance matrices were, but you could find them, okay? You could find theta, because you just, you know, you'd fit, you just say, okay, the mean, mean one, which is going to be the mean of all these points here, the covariance matrix will just find the sample covariance of those points. And then likewise, if you wanted to estimate pi one, you might say, well, okay, let's say that it's the number of points that appeared in this cluster. So that's n1 divided by the total number of points. And so in that way, you could estimate theta. So if you know Z, you know, you can probably get theta. And likewise, the other way around, if you know theta, you could probably guess Z. So if I told you where the three Gaussians were, then, so I already told you what the means were and the covariance matrices, then you could look at these points and you could say, I think probably these points should be, all these Zs should be, the first element should be set to 1, because, you know, if that Gaussian's there, I don't think that these points were generated from any of the other Gaussians. So you can have a good guess at estimating your labels, your latent variables. So that's the final thing I wanted to say, really. So the EM algorithms, we'll see, is useful for those situations where you've got these parameters and these latent variables. Finding them both at the same time is difficult, but you can find one if you hold the other constant, and vice versa. So that's really when it comes in handy. I said that was the final thing, but actually, just as a final note, just as something, just to sort of clarify an equation you might see when you look at Gaussian mixture models. If we consider the probability that we're going to see, let's say the nth point, so let's say the probability that, you know, xn appears, this is equal to, well, what we're going to do is marginalize over z. So if we say, if we look at, well, what's the probability of xn given that, let's say for zn, let's say the kth element was equal to 1, so that means that xn came from the kth Gaussian, times the probability that Znk equals 1. And you sum that over all possible values of Zn. You can see I've used a lowercase p for everything here, even though, you know, we're actually kind of mixing continuous and discrete variables here, but I think it's okay. I think you know what I mean. So then we can say, right, well, Znk, that means it came from the kth Gaussian. So we know that the probability of Xn, that's just our normal distribution with uk and sigma k as the mean covariance matrix, with Xn as the kind of random variable, and then the probability that if any x that it came from the kth Gaussian is just equal to pi k. So that thing, this just to clarify, that might be the, you know, when you look up a Gaussian mixture model, that might be the first thing that comes up as you see that equation. Okay, so let's say we have some input data, x, which is two-dimensional. So let's say we've got an x1 first component, x1 second component, x2 first component, x2 second component, down to, let's say, an xn first component, xn second component. Okay, and then we also have some kind of outputs, some corresponding outputs written as y. We've got a y1, a y2, so we assume the y's are, let's say, they're one-dimensional in this case, down to a yn. And we think there's some kind of relationship between these x's and this y, and that's what we want to find. And then let's also say, for example, that y might be noisy. So let's say that y are kind of observations from an experiment or something, and so it'll be subject to some kind of measurement noise. So in this case, what we'd usually do, if we're going to do, let's say, linear regression, linear in parameters and inputs, then we're going to hypothesize that we have a model, which I'm going to write as f, it's a function of xn. So xn is like the nth kind of row here, is equal to, and then I'm just going to say, well, it's some parameter alpha 1 times the first component of x1 plus parameter alpha 2 times the second component of xn, which you can just write as a vector transpose times xn. So this thing, so alpha transpose is just alpha 1 and alpha 2. Then I said we're going to consider the situation where the y's might be noisy observations of what happened. So when we have that kind of situation, we need a kind of a model to describe the noise. So in this case, I'm just going to say that we think that the nth observation we had, we're going to hypothesize if our model's really good, it's going to be equal to the output of our model, xn, f of xn, plus some kind of noise, where that noise has been generated, let's say for this example, from a Gaussian distribution with variance sigma squared. Okay. So this is a pretty standard linear regression problem. The justification for this thing being Gaussian can get quite complicated, so we'll skip over it for now and we'll just kind of accept it for this, you know, for the sake of this, given kind of context to where we might use the EM algorithm. So here, the parameters we need to find, typically, we would certainly need to find this alpha 1 and alpha 2. So alpha 1 and alpha 2. Then also we might want to estimate what this sigma squared is as well. Okay. So they are our parameters to find. And you can do this. So in fact, you can find closed form solutions for what the optimum alpha 1, alpha 2 and sigma squared can be. And actually, if you can phrase this as a Bayesian problem, and if you choose the right priors and do a bit of maths, you can get closed form solutions for what your a posterior probability distribution could be over alpha 1, alpha 2 and even sigma squared. Okay, so that's fine. That's the parameters we want to find. But now let's say that one of these let's just say one of them for now is missing. Okay, trying to find the right thing here. So the sensor went wrong or something, and this came out as a, let's say, you know, you're using Python or something, this actually came out as a not a number or something. So now we have a missing data point and possibly more than one. So in this situation, let's say perhaps these data points cost a lot of money to generate, then this is something that we would like to know if possible. So one option is, you know, there's lots of ways of dealing with missing data, but you know, the crudest thing is we could perhaps just remove this from our analysis. But like I say, perhaps it costs lots of money, perhaps it's really important for some other reason. So what we're going to do is we're going to call this our latent variable. So that's a Z, okay? And then the collection of latent variables, let's say there could be, you know, a load of them, Z1, Z2. They would be, you know, the collection of all the missing data points in our input data set X. Okay, so now we've got our parameters defined, that's theta, and the latent variables, they're hidden to us because there were X's, there was an X22, you know, it did happen. We just weren't able to measure it for some reason, so that's been hidden to us. So again, all I want to emphasize here is this is the kind of situation where if you know one thing, you can find the other. So if you know the Z's, if I told you what the missing data points were, then it's back to just standard linear regression. We can find the thetas, no problem. Likewise, if I told you the thetas, if I told you what the real model was, which is kind of a plane cutting through this. So we've got an X1, X2 component. And we've kind of got a, you know, our model is like a plane being fitted through that. A flat plane because everything's linear. So if I told you what that plane was by basically telling you what these alphas are, and let's say, you know, perhaps this sigma as well, then you can imagine that in that case, that's why, that in that case, you would be able to work out what these missing values would be as well. Or at least, given that we've, our Y's are noisy observations of the truth, so they've been corrupted by this Gaussian noise, you would be able to work out perhaps a probability distribution over what our missing values should be. So again, this is a case where we've got parameters defined, theta, we've got latent variables, Z. The point I wanted to make is that, you know, again, it's the case where if you know theta, you could probably have a go at estimating Z. And then if you know Z, then you could probably have a go at estimating theta. So this is another situation where the EM algorithm would be suitable. Okay, so now we've got two contextual examples. In the next video, we'll go into the details and look at how the EM algorithm really, really works.